Necessity, they say, is the mother of invention. We have a lot of necessity in our society today.
What we're going through now is a fundamental cultural shift. We're handing over more and more responsibilities for life and our society and civilization to our machines. Transportation, communications, health, the infrastructure of our world. We're talking about AI now, where the robots are thinking for themselves, even to the brink of consciousness.
I always want to know, where's the human going to be in this story? What's it going to be like to be human in a world where the machines now act without asking us?
We've made this incredible technological jump in one human lifetime. All because of Bob Noyce and the integrated circuit.
Father of Silicon Valley is a term I hear used to describe Bob Noyce. How do you feel when you hear that term?
A little humble, a little proud. What can I say?
A new day has dawned. The integrated circuit gives us capabilities that couldn't have been imagined just a decade ago.
One question which we might ask is, why do people care about integrated circuits?
The integrated circuit is the most important invention in Silicon Valley history.
To understand the importance of the integrated circuit, we need to back up and look at the vacuum tube.
The very first computer at scale ran on valves.
The heart of all these electronic systems has been the vacuum tube.
Valves were big and fragile.
The breakthrough, the transistor, made it much more sturdy and durable.
These tiny transistors are destined to play a big part in our electronic age.
The year is 1959. Bob Noyce is running a company called Fairchild Semiconductor. And initially, Fairchild was going to be a transistor company. But Bob Noyce, he had had an idea for taking that solid-state transistor and making it flat. You take a sheet of silicon, and then you print the circuitry on top of it in metal. It turns out you can take that and supercharge it, reproducing it by the dozens, then by the hundreds, and now we do billions.
Integrated circuits now perform critical tasks in almost all areas of healthcare.
It is in your wristwatch.
Modern transportation systems.
Your pocket calculator.
Communication that is instantaneous and global.
Automatic street lights and space shuttles.
Liftoff.
It is everywhere.
This tiny piece of silicon is revolutionizing the way we live.
Fairchild gets rich making the integrated circuit, but it was just volatile. The parent company, Fairchild, back east, didn't really support it. They were seeing it as a cash cow, took the money out of it. So everybody quit. Noyce leaves with Gordon Moore and Andy Grove to found Intel. Within a decade, they were being called the most important company in the world. To understand Robert Noyce and why he was such an important historic figure, you first need to understand the boy growing up in Grinnell, Iowa. Son of an itinerant preacher. This was a world of tight community.
I grew up in small town America, which had to be self-sufficient. If something was broke, you fix it yourself.
And he brought that to Intel.
When they started to build Intel, in addition to making integrated circuit technology, they also wanted to make a company that was like nothing that had ever existed. It was everything from saying, there won't be any corner offices. Everyone will have the same space.
The senior executives were just in other cubicles. I remember going into Noyce's office, indistinguishable from anybody else, but on the wall he had the National Medal of Science.
The United States' highest civilian award.
He also believed that everyone should have a piece of the company.
The idea of giving out stock options to employees, even like secretaries.
That was circa 1968, pretty radical.
That just wasn't done on the East Coast. The revolution of Silicon Valley is as much cultural as it is technological.
You know, in some senses, we didn't see what the impact of the integrated circuit would be when that first came out. Its effect has been revolutionary.
1965, Gordon Moore is the chief scientist at Fairchild. He's asked to write an article for an electronics magazine. He sits down with a sheet of graph paper. It's only like the fourth or fifth generation of memory chips. And he plots out those four generations in terms of capacity. And he realizes they're already going off the top of the page. So he gets some logarithmic paper and he plots it again. And he gets a straight line.
I made a prediction for 10 years, a thousandfold increase in complexity. That was a wild extrapolation of very little data.
One of my colleagues dubbed this Moore's Law.
It basically said either the size is going to get smaller, the capacity is going to get greater, or the price is going to get cheaper by a factor of 2 every 2 years.
I always think that Moore's Law is a promise, right? The promise is that every generation will be better than the one that came before.
By a factor of 2.
And everyone will offer more possibility and more potential.
By a factor of 2.
And that cadence will continue.
There's no precedent in the history of mankind for anything like this. By a factor of 2. So he writes an article and he says, you know, if this is going at this pace, by the 1980s we're going to have this, and by 2000 we're going to have this. And it all comes true.
It was far more accurate than I could have anticipated.
The amazing thing is Moore's Law has held up now for 50 plus years. And there's no indication that it's really going to end. We talk about every few years about Moore's Law slowing down. It has slowed down a little bit. But human innovation keeps coming up with replacement technology that maintains Moore's Law, which is why now we're talking about quantum technology. Instead of the ones and zeros of traditional computing, in quantum computing, you still have ones and zeros, but you also have superposed states where it can be both one and zero at the same time. Quantum computers may be a million times, even a billion times faster than today's fastest supercomputers. So there's always doubt that Moore's Law will keep going. But so far, they've managed to punch through every time they hit a wall. They've never stopped advancing the technology, making it smaller and smaller.
As we look on into the future, we're going to find that we can, in effect, put ourselves wherever we want to be without moving. We can create the environment that we want around us.
The great contribution of Moore's Law in the big picture is that it brings intelligence to everything. The age of statistics is over. We don't need to sample anymore. We can just measure everything. We can measure every bird in the sky, every fish that goes by the coast of Australia. We can do all of those things because of Moore's Law has brought us to the point that intelligence can be embedded in anything. How do I feel about those changes? Combination of exhilaration and terror. Exhilaration because, boy, we got a lot of cool toys now. In medical technology, we're extending lifespans, we're curing diseases that were traditionally fatal. Those are wonderful things. By the same token, smart machines, robots, 24/7, 365 surveillance of our lives. Those are deeply worrying things about what it means to be a human being. But I have tremendous faith in human nature. We humans have survived an awful lot for a couple million years. I think the lesson of Bob Noyes is that no matter how advanced the technology gets, you have to stay human. It's very easy to become stratified and lose that sense of we're all in this together.
To get a sneak preview of things to come, we spoke with a pioneer of the electronics industry. Dr. Robert Noyce played a pivotal role in developing the integrated circuit, the solid-state memory, and the microprocessor.
Where do we go from here? Where is the limit? Well, I don't see any stopping.
And I think the time is here for inventing new approaches, new solutions to these various problems. for all of those who will be the achievers of the future. Thanks very much.